beautiful Baha Tustin. We will learn about the topic policies and gaps with the fantabulous economic professor Mark McNeil.
I paid for that endorsement. All right, this is macro, and so we're talking about if you have a gap, assuming that a gap exists, what do you do about it? Well, there are two possibilities. When you have a problem, a gap, you can either do nothing, which has a name. The name of doing nothing is non-intervention. And so let's say that we have, the economy is doing fine, there is no gap, the actual level of output, that intersection here, short run aggregate supply and aggregate demand, is exactly equal to the potential level of output shown by the long run aggregate supply. So there's actual equals potential, there's no gap. But then, as we've seen in this recently, with the crash of the financial this and that, what happened was aggregate demand decreased. And all of a sudden, we had this kind of a situation. I'll draw it fresh here. We were here, and then aggregate demand decreases. And all of a sudden, our actual level of output is less than potential. And so we have a recessionary gap. Now, you have two choices: to do something, which is called a stabilization policy, or do nothing, which is non-intervention. If we do nothing, I just messed up my labor markets here. When there is a gap, the labor markets are not in equilibrium. So if this is the labor markets, that's the supply of labor and the demand for labor, in equilibrium, there is this quantity of labor working. But when the demand for goods and services decreases, the demand for the resources, in this case labor, decreases, and all of a sudden, at the old real wage of W1, you have the quantity supply greater than the quantity demanded. There is a surplus of labor. And further, if you assume that wages resist going down very quickly, that is, that they're sticky, then with this surplus of labor, that sets in motion forces to push the price of labor down and other resources down. As the price of labor and other resources starts to drop, time is an issue. I mean, it may go slowly, it may go quickly. But as the resource prices drop, this shifts the... This is real quantity. That shifts the short-run aggregate supply curve to the right and causes the new equilibrium to be achieved at the potential level of output. And when the new equilibrium is achieved with real GDP, it means that the labor markets are in equilibrium as well. So in with non-intervention policy, the short-run aggregate supply shifts due to changes in the labor and other resource markets. So a non-intervention policy acts on short-run aggregate supply to achieve the new equilibrium. But what if we choose to do something? This is called a stabilization policy. So let's assume the same bit, and that is we are in equilibrium and something happens. In this case, we move into a recession, aggregate demand shifts to the left. This decreases the demand for the resources used in the production process. The biggest resource, of course, is labor. So we show the labor markets. At the old wage level, W1, we have a surplus. And we have here a recessionary gap, because here is the actual level of output, and the long-run aggregate supply curve shows the potential. So when actual is less than potential, we have a recessionary gap. Now, we can do something, that is, stabilize the economy using monetary policy. Monetary policy is done by the Federal Reserve, not the federal government, the Federal Reserve. And the Federal Reserve changes the money supply with the intention of lowering interest rates. Now, when interest rates are lowered because the Federal Reserve has increased the money supply, aggregate demand changes, because aggregate demand is composed of consumption, investment, government, and net exports. And when the interest rates go down, that induces consumers to spend more. It other things constant, it will cause businesses to spend money, more money on investment goods, And for reasons I can't get into right now, it'll cause net exports to rise as well. Now, if any or several, I'm not sure what happens to the government when interest rates change, but if any or all of these components of aggregate demand increase, that shifts the aggregate demand to the right. So the stabilization policy would have the effect of shifting aggregate demand to the right. And when aggregate demand shifts to the right, that increases the demand for the resources necessary to produce them, and we get back to an equilibrium with a stabilization policy. And it turns out that stabilization policies act, close gaps by acting on aggregate demand. Now that's how a monetary policy done by the Fed would close a gap, but we could also have a fiscal policy. A fiscal policy is done by the federal government, and the fiscal policy involves changes in the taxing or spending laws that can affect aggregate demand. So that, for instance, a fiscal policy could be that the government reduces taxes. Hey, thank you. Reduces taxes, this would cause consumers to spend more. The government could also give more investment incentives, which would cause investment to go up. The government could, heaven knows they could, just spend more. Or perhaps bully foreigners to buy more American goods. Any of these policies, if they're intended to close a gap, are fiscal policies. They affect, they are the result of changes in the taxing and spending laws, and they have the effect of changing aggregate demand to close a gap. So that's it. Policies and gaps. If we have a gap, what do we do about it? We can do nothing. In which case, that would be a non-intervention policy. We would just let things happen, and because of the surpluses in the resource markets, resource prices go down, that shifts short-run aggregate supply to the right and closes the gap. And when the gap is closed, the resource markets are back in equilibrium, at a lower wage, but back in equilibrium. And it turns out that with a non-intervention policy, the price level goes down a bit as well. Now, if we do something, that's a stabilization policy. Stabilization policies come in two flavors, monetary and fiscal policy, and they both work to act on aggregate demand, to shift the aggregate demand in the correct direction to close the gaps. There we go. Thank you very much. Bye, Edgar.